the Diamond Sutra. Meditation is your ultimate flowering. This week, I will continue on certain aspects of meditation. Still a few aspects needed to be explained, and from next week I will be going on another very important aspect on which not much has been spoken, is reincarnation real or myth? Is reincarnation real or myth? On this issue, Hindus have spoken extensively on reincarnation. They believe in it. Christians do not. Muslims do not believe in reincarnation. Who is right and who is wrong? All these issues, what actually happens and what is this process of reincarnation called? I will start this series. It will require a couple sessions to explain in details about this aspect of reincarnation. Is it real or is it an illusion? It is both or it is none. The truth is neither this nor that. Truth is as is. Just as someone has asked, is suffering real or an illusion? When anything is to be spoken from the level of totality, can use the middle path, the tightrope walker, to lean on this side or that side to maintain the balance. Suffering is both an illusion and reality. Mind can never conceive of that. Mind chooses either of the two. Either it is an illusion or it is real. How can it be both? It is like you are asking me, can I walk and sit same time? Is it possible? Yes, it is possible. Yes, it is possible and you do it. But you do not know how to understand it. How you do it? Walking means you are traveling a distance. You are traveling a distance. And sitting means you are stationary. Your feet are not moving. But walking is an act of the movement of the feet, and sitting is just the opposite. How can the two be possible? How can the two be possible? Can you use your imagination to decide how can you remain sitting and walk and cover a distance? You can sit down in a wheelchair, your feet will not be moving, but you can cover a distance. You can move from one place to another using your hands to pedal the wheels. You sit in the car. Car is moving at a speed, but you are sitting and you are covering a distance. It is beyond the mind. Yes, when I say suffering is an illusion, it is an illusion for an awakened one. And it is a reality for the one who is ignorant. If there is a loss of finance, if there is a loss of job, the ignorant one will lament and it will come to him as a suffering. On the contrary, the one who is awakened, or awakening is arising in him, he will look at it differently. He will say, what is the wish of the Master of God in this? Maybe it is the beginning of something new. Maybe greater things are in the womb to take birth. Whatsoever is happening has to be for a reason that I may not understand it now. So it is both a suffering as well as an illusion. It depends on your level of consciousness. In the same way, reincarnation is a myth, and it is reality both. From next week, I will start speaking on various aspects of reincarnation, but for now, the remainder of the aspects of meditation. Meditation is your ultimate flowering. When meditation begins to blossom in you, tremendous intelligence comes. Intelligence not of an ordinary type. Infinite intelligence, a radiant intelligence. Meditation makes you more and more alive and sensitive, and it leads you to a very rich life. But your mind is very cunning. It goes on rationalizing all its actions. Ordinarily, people are violent towards the others. You turn to be non-violent. But the seed of violence is still in you. Mind plays its tricks. It can learn non-violence. Mind says, it is easy. It will learn non-violence. Now the mind becomes violent towards itself. Now instead of being violent to others, mind convinces you to be non-violent to others, but the seed is still in you, and you start becoming violent to yourself and to those close to you. Mahatma Gandhi is known to be the propagator of non-violence. As I said, the person who starts leaning towards non-violence becomes violent to himself. Violent to yourself means you are torturing yourself and the people who are in the close proximity. Gandhiji was living in South Africa. That time, Kasturba was expecting. She was pregnant. Gandhiji, in order for the self-service, he released the maid who used to come to clean the house and the restroom areas and so. I'm talking about 100 years ago, what kind of facilities one could conceive of. Gandhi had asked Kasturba to clean the toilet. But you remember, a woman who is pregnant is very susceptible to smells, and it was forced onto her. And one day it happened because she was feeling nauseated and she could not clean the toilet. I remember it was a cold winter night. She was locked out of the house for whole night because she could not clean the toilet. Gandhiji spent his time in Western education. And not only that, he used the Western clothes, etc. His son was born, Haridas was his name. He wanted to study bachelor's in English, and also, like anybody else, want to use the clothes that are in fashion. Almost every growing person, a young person, wants to be in fashion and use the style that is available at that time. But parents always resist. Anything that is in fashion, parents find it, they are antagonistic to that. By then, Gandhiji has joined the movement, freedom movement. He has become Swadeshi, means domesticated. He did not allow Haridas to study bachelor's. So what he is doing, he is imposing his ideology on the person. This is violence in a subtle form, and you cannot see it. Why cannot freedom be given to the person? And once it happened, Gandhiji was staying with Rabindranath Tagore. So it was early morning. Gandhiji used to call him Kavind, let us go for a walk. Early morning walk on the grass when there is dew drops. The grass blades are shining in dew drops, and when sun rays fall on it, it becomes golden. Let us walk on that. You know what was the response of Rabindranath? He said, Mahatma, how can we walk on these pearls that are shining in the golden light of the sun? It is violence. How sensitive Kavindra was, only a poet can be. Only a poet can be so sensitive in that. This is non-violence. Non-violence is an attitude, is an understanding. So when you start, the mind says that I am now following the path of non-violence, but the seed remains there in you. It starts surfacing in some other form. So you start becoming violent to yourself and to those close to you. The mind always finds new tricks. This is the way of the mind. People respect the violence that you do to yourself because it is felt that you are an ascetic, and being an ascetic means to be religious. This is not right. I have known one person who used to be a disciple of my grandfather, and because of his simple ways and means and living, he was popularly known in his college by the students as Gandhiji. So it happened that my grandfather sent my uncle, who became the Sufi master afterwards, to stay and live a life of discipline at Gandhiji's place. He has bare necessities. He was well educated. He had his master's in mathematics, Sanskrit, and he was well versed in other languages as well, but very simple ways and means he followed. He had the bare necessities, means a wooden bed, very thin mattress, and all the seasons, rain, summer, winter, he has to take the shower with the cold water. So one day, this gentleman Gandhiji, that we knew him as, told my uncle that it is good to wake up 4 o'clock in the morning. Every young man wants to sleep. So it happened one day, he said, Bhaiyaji, you should get up 4 o'clock in the morning. Early morning, getting up and taking a shower and then going into meditation and studies is very good. He did not get up, my uncle. Second day, he did not get up. Third day, around 4 o'clock, my uncle was still sleeping, drowsy, and Gandhiji started doing up and down. That is you hold your ears, you sit down and get up, a kind of a self-punishment. So when my uncle heard the noise, hurriedly he got up. And he held on to the feet of Gandhiji. He said, forgive me. He said, no, this is not your fault. I do not have the capacity to bring about transformation in you. That's why I am punishing myself. You see, he has followed the path of non-violence. Mind plays a trick. So instead of torturing the other, mind goes on to the other extreme and he started torturing himself. This is how the mind operates. Because in that case, you are considered a non-violent, but there will be no song in your life, no dance whatsoever. Only your life will become a cemetery. God enjoys life. That is why there is so much aliveness, so much creativity all around you, so much richness, so much variety. God is more epicurious than you can ever imagine. If you think about God, always think in terms of creativity. God is constantly in search of more and more happiness, being creative in myriad ways. You would have seen many kinds of flowers, birds of many colors, but you will not be able to know how many different variety of the flowers are available. You go on looking at the rose flower. So many different colors and hues it comes in. It is an example of the creativity. More joy, more ecstasy, but mind is cunning. It wants to rob you of your joy and bliss. It can even rationalize dullness as transcendence. It can rationalize deadness as renunciation. If you move in the right direction, life will continue to flower in myriad ways, colors and hues. But this is how things are. Cunningness of the mind is infinite. It can rationalize everything. Be aware of this and allow life to blossom into myriad colors. Then a different kind of understanding dawns on you. Remember, there is no technique to meditation. No technique leads to meditation. Meditation is a spontaneous happening. The so-called ancient techniques and also new age scientific biofeed techniques can lead one to meditation. Meditation happens as an outcome of understanding and inner growth. So is enlightenment. Then, what do these techniques do? They simply help the aspirants to remove all that creates an obstacle in the process of inner flowering. All that creates or obstructs the process of inner flowering. Doctors cannot cure. All he does by giving you the medicine removes the obstacles. Health is not in your hand. Health is a blossoming within you. Health is a blossoming within you when there is no obstruction. Health finds freedom to grow. There is no obstructions. Therefore, Health is an aspect which can be said of the fourth dimension. As Hindus speak of fourth dimension, states of consciousness, the sleeping, the dreaming, the waking, and the fourth. Now this is very fourth, the turiya, the fourth dimension is very difficult to understand or reach. Now a patient comes to the hospital, he is in the operation theater going to be operated upon. The anesthetist comes, gives him the anesthesia and asks him to count. And the moment the person begins to count, he knows that the anesthesia has started working. The patient to repeat one. He says one very clearly. Then he says to repeat two. The patient's in a staggering voice says two. And when the anesthetist asks him to repeat three, it becomes staggering and elongated. Three, it goes on a very elongated way. And incomplete, he cannot complete the last number three. And there is no chance for him to repeat four. We cannot go even in a state of unconsciousness into the fourth dimension. Health belongs to the fourth dimension. When you cross all the known boundaries, you enter into an unknown realm, that is meditation. That is health. So meditation belongs to the realm, dimension of the unknown. It is not a byproduct of any technique. It happens beyond the mind. No technique can go beyond the mind. And then it creates a misunderstanding in the scientific circle. Certainly it has a basis. When someone is meditative, certain waves are created in the mind. The wavelength of the mind changes. Wavelength is a technique, is a way. When mind is silent, if your waves, the frequency of the movement of the waves in the mind is measured, use the delta, theta, these are the letters that are used to explain. And when the wavelength falls below four, you enter in a state of sleep. And when it is beyond the double digit, you cannot fall asleep. You cannot see what is happening. So what happens there? There is a cause and effect relation. Because of the inner happening, the wavelength is changing. This is an effect. By understanding an effect, you cannot create the cause. Cause is the one that creates an effect. But the reverse is not possible. By creating those waves, you cannot attain to calmness. because those waves are only the outcome. They are the symptoms. They are the indicators. It is good to study those. But there is no short cut for meditation. No mechanical device can ever be of any help in meditation. It is not a question of sitting silently or a question of chanting any specific word as mantra. It is an understanding of the subtle functioning of the mind. The moment you understand the subtle functioning of the mind, something begins to happen. A great awareness arises in you. And that is, that awareness that arises in you is not of the mind. Instead, it is the outcome of understanding the functioning of the mind. This awareness arises in your being, in your consciousness. Mind is only a mechanism. But when that awareness arises, it is bound to create an energy field around it. Mind takes note of this energy pattern. The mind is a subtle mechanism, and you are studying it from outside. So at the most, you can study the mind. Whenever a person is silent, serene, and peaceful, a certain wave pattern is created in the mind. Scientific thinking can create such wave patterns in the mind through certain biofeed technology. It is understood then that the being will definitely reach the heights of awareness. But this is not going to happen. It is certainly not the question of cause and effect. Those waves thus arising in the mind are not the cause of meditation. On the contrary, those waves are the effect of inner happening. When something happens within your innerness, within your biology, a conception takes place, a growth happens, fetus is formed, it goes through the various stages. There comes changes in the body mechanism. Those changes are the outcome of the inner happening. If you study those and you bring somehow or the other mechanically those changes in your body, can that reverse the process and bring the conception in an individual? Certainly not. Because conception is an outcome of inner functioning, a confluence, a merger of ovum and sperm. And because of this merger of ovum and sperm, a process has started within the biology. The effects are there. So those waves thus arising in the mind are not the cause of meditation when you create them scientifically through biofeed technique. On the contrary, those waves are the effect of inner happening. Those waves, when it is the outcome of inner happening, there is so much of silence. The body does not want to move. You are watching this broadcast live. I am speaking. And this speaking is happening out of my inner silence. That is why these words are so soothing and comforting. I do not need to move my hand or feet because it is not necessary. It is not a conversation out of mind. Instead, it is a message. It is the silence that is assuming the form of the words. What did I see? It is the silence that has assumed the form of words. Silence is decoded into the words analog. It converted into digital, reaches your mechanism. Again, your system converts these digital sound waves into analog and it reaches you. So what is actually reaching you, riding the waves of words? It is the silence that reaches you. That is why the poet says, it is the state when rooh bhi kuch ghafil hoti hai, aur main hi akela hota hun. There is a kind of an intoxication. You have heard the intoxication that comes out of alcohol. But certainly you have not experienced the intoxication that comes out of a process when silence begins to overcome you. I am speaking. The words are forming, but there is no movement. There is no bodily movement. It is the silence, it is the harmony, it is the oneness, it is the noor. Whatsoever name you want to give it, but its magnanimity is such that no name can encompass it in any way. It is this that is reaching you through the words. And when it reaches you, it keeps you spellbound and you have no word to explain to this. Because you are being put in a state of meditation. Now, there is silence in you, but this silence is outcome of the inner silence which is being communicated to you, communed to you. Certain waves are arising in your mind. These waves are the effect of inner happening. These waves are the effect of the silence that is being communed beyond time and space. What is the distance between where you are and where I am? Time zones. Different time zones we are in. Someone is 9.5 hours ahead of me of the Eastern time. Last night we had a meditation session in Brisbane. 14 hours time difference, and the effect is beyond. Certainly through these devices you can create a certain patterns in the mind. The modern techniques, the biofeed, they will give you a feeling of peace, silence and serenity to the person. But that is not meditation, because these will not transform you. You may go on practicing such scientific instruments for years or lifelong. It will not bring about any inner change. It will not change your individuality. A moment A moment spent in that communion can bring about a transformation. Love happens in a moment. The moment the two eyes dissolve into one another, a communication happens. Meeting is a moment's ecstasy. Meeting is a moment's ecstasy. Meditation transforms, and if that communication between the two eyes has happened, something is born in you and then begins to grow. That is love. Meditation transforms you. It takes you to higher levels of consciousness. And with that experience, your entire life will begin to change. All your reactions will become responses now. It is unbelievable. A person who would normally react out of anger in the same situation is now acting out of compassion. Meditation is the state of your being. A state has arrived to understanding. This requires intelligence, not technique. And then you are delighted in your own presence. I do not need anything for entertainment. My own company is the greatest entertainment. This comes through meditation. It is being delighted in your own presence, in your own being. It is simple and natural. It is being totally in a relaxed state of consciousness. Speaking is happening. The inner silence is assuming the form of words. Words are reaching you. There is no need for me to move my hand or anything, because there is no communication. You are not doing anything. The moment you do something, tension comes in, anxiety breeds in. And you will begin to wonder how many people are listening to this live broadcast. What is their response? Do they like it? I am simply overflowing whether it pleases anyone or not. It is releasing a certain energy field within the cosmos. And that cannot be destroyed. If you can tune into that energy field, you are communed. If you are doing such broadcasts to gain something. What do I have to gain out of this? The greatest gain that I have, that one day I was ignorant like you, then something happened. Certain eyes have created an inroads into my being. The being began to drown into that ocean, into the depth of those eyes. Change began to happen. I must pay my debt, my gratitude towards the existence. But giving me that experience of harmony and oneness. Many years ago, I happened to pass through a cemetery. There is always an epitaph on which something is written. And on this grave, certain words were engraved. When I read those words, it got an engraving deep within me. Look at me, O passers-by. A message, a public message. Look at me, O passers-by, as you are now, I was ever. Look at me, O passers-by, as you are now, I was ever. As I am now. As I am now, you will be in future. What a great message this man, in his passing away, through the epitaph, through his grave he gives. There was nothing else written. I tried to decipher when was it written, what is the name of the person. The person did not care even to have the name written there or anything. When he was born, when did he die? Simply the message is important. Not where it comes from, because all messages comes from the unknown and unknowable, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If that is to happen in that way, the message comes from the unknown and unknowable. So message was very important. Look at me, O passers-by, as you are now, I was ever. As I am now, you will be in future. You are not doing anything and yet still it is happening. Where is it coming from? You may wonder. Is it coming from this side or that? It is coming from everywhere. Or from a specific source. It is not the cause of anything. Remember, the existence is made up of this stuff called joy. That is why it is said that it is the noor. Kabir sang, ek noor se sab jag upjayo. It is through that noor, through that light, the entire creation came into existence. Light assumed myriad forms. It is the light that gave aliveness to a man, to a flower, to mountain, to rivers, to stars, to moon, to entire existence. There is no cause, no reason, yet still it is happening. Your unhappiness needs a reason. But when you are happy, you are simply happy. No reason whatsoever, but mind tries to find a reason for everything. Mind is utilitarian. It cannot conceive. Anything can happen without a reason or cause. But when inner blossoming begins to happen, there is no cause needed for it. If anything happens beyond cause, the mind loses its control and it becomes impotent. So the mind goes on creating reasons and causes. Remember, when you are happy for no reason at all. You are made up of this stuff that called bliss, that called surur. Happiness is your innermost core, your very being. Look at the trees, the birds, the clouds, the stars. If your eyes are open, open eternally, you will be able to see the entire existence is blissful, is dancing. Everything is simply happy. Trees are happy for no reason, it goes on blossoming. Trees cannot become the prime minister or the president of a country. They are not going to be rich. No bank balance whatsoever. Look at the flowers. Look at their beauty and the fragrance and the hue, the color. They blossom because there is inner joy, and it is the blossoming is their inner nature. This blossoming is their inner nature. You cannot do anything. Living in such a state of blissfulness, blossoming in a state of inner ecstasy is meditation. Nothing is needed to be done. Yet still myriad flowers begin to blossom in you. Then you can dance and walk gaily without any reason. You are happy for no reason. When you look at the flowers, their colors, the fineness on the petals, the streaks, the hue, the color, the fragrance, everything. What is the outcome? Why do flowers blossom? Have you ever thought why do flowers blossom? You are doing something because you have invited a guest, or your beloved friend is coming, or it is your birthday. It is not the birthday of the flower. Flower has not gained anything, it has not won any laurels, but it cannot do anything otherwise except blossoming, except bringing its beauty and fragrance. And it does not matter if anybody appreciates it. I have decided to share my presence, my inner silence, my inner blossoming. If that appeals to you, you will come. You will come like a moth, like a butterfly. You cannot resist yourself. The butterflies cannot resist themselves. The honeybees cannot resist themselves when the flower blossoms. They start humming around to drink a drop of that nectar. And then what they do? They collect the nectar from the flower to flower and return to their solitary realm, process them into a life-giving substance called honey. So this flowering, so it is not that the flowers are blossoming because the butterflies will come and hum around me, the honeybees will come and around me. It is my nature to blossom. What can I do if I do not blossom because I know nothing else other than blossoming? I know nothing other than allowing my innerness to express it in myriad ways. And that is what I go on sharing with anyone who comes in my company in myriad ways. It is the inner silence, it is the inner harmony, it is the oneness, or whatsoever name you want to give it, is being shared. Words are assuming the form of, It is the silence. It is out of the silence the words are assuming like the. It is the words that are overflowing and reaching you is nothing but the blossoming of the silence, blossoming of the harmony. When my inner silence, inner harmony, inner oneness blossoms into myriad words and they reach you, they create something, groups in your consciousness, connects you to your being, gives you a taste of your being. This is meditation. This is meditation. My inner silence is reaching in you in myriad forms. In myriad forms. Then you can say, Meri saansein hain teri nazar. My each breath is offered unto you. Each breath is offered unto you. A myriad salutations to you. Meditation is delight in your being. When meditation blossoms in you, you are full of joy for no reason. You cannot explain the blissfulness that you feel within. Just remain like this, silent for a few moments to imbibe, to allow this to absorb into your very, to absorb in the very texture of your beings, into your every cell of the body. This is meditation beyond time and space. Beyond time and space.